Welcome to the American Humanist Association's Speaking of Humanism series. My name is Emily Newman, and I'm the AHA's Senior Education Coordinator. Today, I'm happy to share why animal rights is a humanist issue with Corey Wrenn. Dr. Wrenn is a lecturer of sociology with the School of Social Policy, Sociology, and Social Research, and co-director of the Center for the Study of Social and Political Movements at the University of Kent. She served as a council member with the American Sociological Association's Animals and Society section, was elected chair in 2018, and co-founded the International Association of Vegan Sociologists in 2020. She serves as book review editor for Society and Animals, an editor for the Sociological Quarterly, is a member of the Vegan Society's Research Advisory Committee, and hosts Sociology and Animals podcast. So thank you so much, Corey, for coming with us today, and especially since you are in a very different time zone. So that's why we bumped this to afternoon so we can hear from you.
Yes, thank you very much for having me and for accommodating me. So yes, I am American, but living in beautiful Canterbury in southeast England. Oh, get confused. I'm really excited to do this talk. And we were just chatting before the talk started that I got quite a lot of email from folks who saw the advertisement for this talk. So I do believe that there's a real hunger for this topic area, this intersection, if you will. So I'm really, really pleased to have the opportunity to talk about this. This is something that actually I have a bit of history with. It's kind of interesting, 10 years or so since I first dabbled in trying to intersect these two areas, that now I have the great honor to speak to you folks on this. So what I aim to do in this talk is, I realize I probably have two different audiences here. I have folks who already recognize that there's an intersection between free thinking, rational thought, and animal rights advocacy and veganism. And then I'm sure that there's some folks who are tuning in and wondering what the heck do those have to do with anything at all with each other. So I'm going to try to juggle that as best I can. So for those of you who are not really familiar with what animal rights is, and when I say is, it's like the Animal Rights Project. I'll give a brief introduction about what that project is. And then I'm going to kind of highlight how I think that there's a lot that it has to offer for the Humanist Project as well. And this talk is not a super long talk, so maybe if folks who have been thinking about this for a little bit longer want to share their expertise in the comments, I'd be really pleased to see that. And I will say, I'm not the only one who's doing this work. There's a lot of folks, including a colleague of mine, Jamie Woodhouse, who does the Sentientism Project. And he has this amazing YouTube channel where he interviews a bunch of people, and it's also run as a podcast. There's Kim Socha, and I'll talk a little bit about this work towards the end, by the way. But I just wanted to highlight that there is kind of a group of people who've been trying to do this work for a while. So if you're one of those people and you have some of that expertise, or maybe you've never thought about animal rights at all and some things come to mind, I really encourage people to use the chat function to kind of crowdsource that. So then, of course, I'm going to also have to talk about how there's been a lot of intersectional failure when it comes to these two projects, the Humanist Project and the Animal Rights Project. So I'm going to be talking you through a few of those. And then I'm also going to interject along the way some of my own research. So I specialize in social movement studies. So as you saw, I co-direct a social movement center at my university here at University of Kent. And pretty much all of my work is about from the social movement sort of perspective. It's a subfield in sociology. It's quite interdisciplinary. So I specialize in that, and I specialize in vegan studies. And so I've done a little bit of work on how atheism and free thinking in general has a lot to contribute to animal rights and veganism. So I will interject a little bit of that into this talk. So actually, I have been a vegan for a very long time. I'm 38 now, and I turned vegan when I was 17. So I've been vegan for most of my life. I turned vegetarian when I was 13 years old, and I've always, always, always been an animal lover. They're a major, major part of my life. And by the way, this is Mishka zonked out on the sofa behind me. We just got back from a walk. So it's always been very, very important to me, caring about animals, cohabitating with other animals, seeing animals as persons, self-aware, sentient beings, and really family members and friends. And so it's a major, major part of who I was. It's so much so that I grew up, and you might hear my accent, I grew up in the South. I grew up in a small mountain town in Appalachia, and I didn't know any other vegans, much less any other vegetarians. And so it was something that was just that important to me that I felt like this is something I need to pursue, animal rights, veganism, even though I was all alone in a sea of like a hunting community, basically. But also kind of weird is that I'm a lifelong atheist. So I've been vegan for over 20 years, but I've been an atheist for 38 years. I've always been an atheist. I was not raised an atheist, but I was not raised with religion. And I just always, I mean, as soon as I figured out what the word atheist meant, it's like, oh, that's what I am. And really, it wasn't until I was much older that my mom kind of opened up and says, yeah, I'm atheist too. And so we all kind of figured out, yeah, it's not that we just weren't with, we didn't have religion. We just actively don't believe in that kind of stuff. And we found religion problematic in a lot of ways. So I've always been atheist. And it just, for me, it makes a lot of sense. This kind of veganism and this atheism, it's about critically thinking. It's about recognizing what is right and what is wrong. And it's recognizing power structures and hierarchies and how they can sometimes be problematic. So actually, when I kind of got started in my career, really in graduate school, I was really passionate about kind of bringing these two things together. Really, the first thing I got excited about in my line of work was that I was a budding sociologist. I was learning about the scientific method, and I'd been an activist since my late teens. And it really frustrated me because we had so much research in this huge body of social movement theory and this huge body of research that tells us what works and what doesn't. We have evidence. We have the joy of science to help us figure out effective strategies. And yet the animal rights movement was just kind of in this mire of, well, this is the way we do it because it's the way it's always been done. Or this is the way we do it because PETA or HSUS or any other large animal rights welfare group, this is how they do it. So I guess this is how we will do it. And there just wasn't a lot of critical thinking, and there really wasn't any appreciation for science. I think that only recently is starting to change. But when I first got started when I was in graduate school, blending my scientific work with my advocacy work, it was very frustrating that there was a major, major gap there. So from there, I actually started to get a little bit more interested in, okay, not just bringing the scientific method in, but also maybe bringing in atheism, bringing in a challenge to religion. Because one of the first things you will notice as a vegan or an animal rights supporter is that religion is a major, major kind of area of speciesism. And speciesism is systemic level discrimination against non-human animals. And so religion is something that really we should be paying attention to as animal advocates. And really, historically, the animal rights movement has not necessarily challenged religion. I think there's reasons for that, which we can talk about. So myself and a few other activists who were atheists and getting inspired by the new atheist movement, we're starting to look at ways that we can bridge these two. In fact, I actually briefly wrote for Skeptic many years ago, and Rebecca actually told me, it's like, are you sure you want to do this? Because people are not going to be very receptive to this. When I said, well, what I'm writing about is based in science, is based in evidence. Why would people, if she was actually right, I didn't write for Skeptic very long because actually I found that the atheist movement is very, 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 very opposed to animal rights messaging. Alternatively, and we're going to talk about this a little bit later, the atheist movement is one of the biggest areas for us to explore. It's very paradoxical. But I actually really became burned out on the atheist movement. It wasn't just that they were very, very vegan phobic and very, very much so kind of in bed with speciesism, but there was also, back to the Skeptic thing, this is back when the Richard Dawkins thing blew up with Elevator Gate and all that kind of stuff. And there was just this big divide. People who were saying that feminist principles have no business in atheism, and these are two separate things. So anyway, long story short, I found it to be a very toxic place. I found it to be very toxic as a woman and as a vegan. And so I said bye-bye to the new atheist movement and really didn't look back until today. This is like really my first time kind of officially dabbling in it again. So that's just the background. I just want to give you a little background on who I am and why I feel like I have something to offer here. As a lifelong atheist, but also someone who's been trying to bridge these two areas for a very long time. and not necessarily successfully. But hopefully this talk will get people thinking a little bit more, with a little bit more excitement about the possibilities. Okay, so for those of you who don't know anything about animal rights, the term animal rights is kind of used colloquially to refer to treating animals with respect. It's rooted in the human rights tradition. So I think there's a misnomer about animal rights that it somehow developed separate from the Human Rights Project. That's absolutely not the case. The very first animal rights activists, the big ones in the 1800s, a lot of those people were abolitionists. A lot of them were suffragettes, and they saw the Animal Rights Project as a natural extension of what they were already doing, fighting against colonialism, fighting against sexism, and so on and so forth. So there was this historical kind of interconnection from the very beginning. And so this idea that these things are separate, that never was the case. Now, so later on, maybe in the 20th century, we might see more of a siloing effect. But really now, as we are entering the what I would call the third wave of animal rights, we're seeing a much, much more, a bigger commitment to intersectionality again. Hence the work that I do. A lot of the work that I do is about the bridges between critical race theory, feminist theory, atheism, and animal rights. And there's a lot, like I said, there's a lot of other folks who are exploring those intersections as well. And so the research that I'm finding is that animal rights activists today are not always just for animals. The majority of the people, at least the people in the studies I've done, the majority of people are actually interested in multiple issues, human and non-human. So the two have always been really connected. So I just wanted to push it back on this notion that they're somehow separate. And historically also, we have different types of kind of vegetarian, vegan, animal rights movements that existed in the 19th century. There were people who were vegan or vegetarian for spiritual purposes or for health purposes. But within the animal rights movement itself, there was a lot of interest in using reason, science, and again, those principles of human rights towards other animals. In fact, the vegan movement, the vegan society got started in 1944 here in Britain, but it had actually been part of an ongoing debate with the vegetarian society for many decades. And you can actually go back and look at some of the first publications by early vegans, and they make it very explicitly clear. Religion has no place in what we do. Science is our best friend. We need to use evidence, and we need to conduct research, and we need to push back on the woo-woo. And so actually science and evidence seeking was a major part of the early foundations of the vegan movement. So there's a lot of ways that people understand animal rights within that larger framework. And again, this is coming from a scientific background. A lot of the modern animal rights movement has academia to thank. It's kind of unique in that way, where a lot of academics have been very important for shaping the goals of the movement and the strategies of the movement. Specifically philosophy. So Peter Singer, very famously in his book, 1975, with Animal Liberation, he's part of a larger Oxford group. And there were several academics who were working at Oxford, and their wives also were very important in contributing to this early philosophy. And it culminated in a number of articles and books, and specifically Animal Liberation had a big impact. And he bases his theory on the capacity to suffer. So kind of appealing to that biological similarity that other animals have with humans. A little bit later in the early 1980s, we have Tom Reagan. He's an American philosopher. And he also is kind of making an appeal to that biological kind of similarity that we have with other animals. And he used the language of the subject of life. So that is, is an animal self-aware? Does an animal have interest in what happens to them? We can also look at law. So legal scholars have also contributed quite a bit to the Animal Rights Project, hence the rights bit that we use colloquially to understand this. So folks like Lee Hall, who's a feminist legal scholar who does animal rights stuff, has said, actually, maybe we need to be thinking about this in terms of personhood. So recognizing non-human animals as persons, as individuals, again, who are self-aware and have interests. And there's lots of other ways that people like coming from different disciplines have sought to describe animal rights. But I think those in a nutshell are useful for today's purposes. So again, one of the main things that we do in animal rights is we're challenging speciesism. Again, speciesism is that system level discrimination against other animals. Also the individual bit, like, I love bacon, or ooh, I hate spiders and you want to smash them. Like, that's individual level. But especially for sociologists, we're very much so interested in the system level discrimination. So how is speciesism, discrimination against other animals, embedded in all the different institutions of our society? And they are indeed embedded in many, many, many of our institutions. So there's a lot of division in the animal rights movement about how we tackle that or what goals that we're interested in. I'd say a good majority of animal rights folks are really interested in welfare improvements. So that is either they believe that the world will never be vegan, or they believe that the world will be, it'll take a million years before the world goes vegan. So in the meantime, let's just focus on making their suffering a little bit less. So those folks will do work in saying, making like cages slightly bigger, or making sure bolt guns are used in slaughterhouses instead of using an old pole axe. But we also have folks who are very much so for total liberation. So it's not about making things slightly nicer. This is actually about completely upending speciesism as a system, as that system is unethical and should be abolished outright. So you have the same kind of divisions actually within other social movements. We saw this also with the anti-slavery movement. There were folks who said, we need to gradually ease out slavery, or we need to just make slavery a little bit nicer for people. And then there was folks who says, no, actually slavery is absolutely wrong and it needs to be abolished, and it needs to be abolished right now. But you can imagine there's lots of tactical debates that go on behind that as well about what is actually practical and achievable. Ultimately, what's going to happen is that we have to have a challenge to the way that we consume. And increasingly with climate change, even folks who are not really interested in seeing non-human animals as persons, climate change is going to force a lot of consumption changes anyway. Animal agriculture is one of the major contributors to climate change. It's right up there with transportation, although it's one that we don't talk about very much for political reasons. And so you can imagine then, if we're going to be uprooting speciesism or challenging it in any significant way, that we're going to have major societal restructuring. So this is what we're talking about with animal rights. You can imagine how it's a major threat, not just to personal values for people, but also to the state, to industries, to elites. So in fact, in many Western countries, to be an animal rights activist, even to be a vegan, is considered a terrorist, to be terrorist activity. So that you can actually look up online, they'll have like for security, the border patrol folks, they have a guide, like here's the things to look out for. And they'll have lots of different peaceful animal rights groups. The Vegan Society is also included on there. I was stopped in New Zealand because they thought I was a terrorist. It's a whole nother story. I got completely searched because I told them I was there for an animal rights conference. So anyway, that's kind of what we're dealing with animal rights. It's calling for a major, major change to the way we structure our society. So as I said, animal rights has, it has a lot of interest in religion, because religion is a major area where not just a lot of abuse and use of non-human animals happens, but it's where a lot of ideological work happens. Because even for folks like me, I was raised atheist, I grew up in a Christian society, and the values of Christianity are all around us. So even for people who are raised atheists, like, we are still influenced by religious values that are around us. So when we're looking in religion, these institutions, they tend to treat non-human animals in ways where they're just the most oppressed. So for the new atheist movement, I feel like if you care about reducing suffering, you really need to pay attention to how religious institutions treat non-human animals. So a lot of religions, if not all religions, preach love and compassion. But on the other hand, a lot of these religions also teach us that non-human animals should be subservient to us, and that they are there to be sacrificed, or they're there for us to use. God has given animals for us to sustain us or whatever. We should just be good stewards to them. So these kind of ideologies are still very important for shaping the way we interact with other animals today. But even so, like, there's a lot of religious sanctioning of animal violence. There's still a lot of animal sacrifice that happens across the world. Major, major sacrifices that happens in part of Asia where there's just like mass slaughters. Like, we see the animal here. A lot of sheeps and other animals come from Western countries and are shipped to Muslim countries where they will be killed in ritual sacrifices. Live export is one of the most abhorrent, horrific practices on earth. And that's Western farmers pushing them over to places where they're slaughtered in really nasty conditions as well. But also, it's not just Muslim countries where religious sacrifice is taking place. We just had Easter last weekend. And most people sat down with some kind of dead animal at the table. And that also is that animal was sacrificed for that Easter dinner. So on one hand, we have love and compassion. On the other hand, animals are below us and animals are there for sacrifice. And oftentimes they have this kind of metaphorical representation in our society. Even in women's traditions, we see this. So I'm a big fan of like paganism and witchcraft and all that, kind of like the secular version of it, but I can't get down on the Wiccan stuff because a lot of it is really romanticizing animal violence once again. So this, for instance, I might be embarrassing myself here, but my date book that I use is like a witchcraft date book, and it's got like fun stuff like herbalism and today's like summer solstice or whatever. But even in this, which it's all about like love and compassion for the earth and peace, man, it's still got like recipes for dead animals. Let's celebrate some, you know, solstice or whatever by killing an animal or eating dead animals. So even women's religions still are, that claim not to be anthropocentric, are still anthropocentric. Are there people who are vegan and Christian and vegan and pagan? Yes. But at the end of the day, the mainstream hegemony of these institutions are still very much so speciesist. So that leaves us on the other side then. What about the people who are not into religion at all? What about the humanists? So I could go on and on. I just not enough room to cram this all on a slide. But just as a couple of examples, the American Humanist Association says it's about leading ethical lives. It's about aspiring to the greater good. And if we want to be progressive and think about being ethical, shouldn't veganism easily fit into that? The humanist is a much longer definition here, and I put stuff in bold because I don't expect you to read it all. But again, informed by science. Well, we have science that veganism is a diet that humans can live on. We have science that veganism is better for the planet. We have science that eating animals hurts animals. So we got a lot of science there. Individual liberty, there's no such thing as individual liberty for the animals that we kill to eat or to use, right? So lots and lots and lots of areas in kind of the humanist doctrine easily aligns with animal rights advocacy and easily aligns with veganism. And here's a little bit of the research I wanted to interject here. So I did a survey back in 2017. And one of the things I was doing, I was really interested in Donald Trump being elected. This is kind of some traumatic research I did. It's like, I have to understand what just happened. Because I got the gist that there was a kind of a vein in the animal rights movement where there were people who were a little bit conservative and voted for Trump. And I'm just thinking, how can a vegan vote for Trump? I just don't understand. So I did this survey. It was almost 300 vegans. This is back when I was living in the US. And there was lots of interesting things that came out of that. But one of the things that I did not expect to come out of this was that half of my respondents were atheist and another 18% were agnostic. So therefore about 75%, basically 3 out of 4 vegans, at least those in my study, were free thinkers. And I thought that was just absolutely astonishing because we don't really talk about atheism or free thinking in the animal rights movement. We do a lot of kind of outreach on like Christmas. And I know I saw lots of memes floating around like please don't eat the lambs on Easter. So they'll appeal quite a lot to religion, but there's really no appeals whatsoever to the atheist and agnostic communities. And the vast majority of these folks, by the way, went vegan out of concern for other animals. They're not going vegan for their health. They're not going vegan because they want to have a lower carbon footprint. They're going vegan because they recognize non-human animals as sentient beings with a right to life, just like we have a right to life. So there's something very, very interesting there. Agnostics, slightly less. They're a little unsure about a lot of things, I guess. But still, the vast majority of agnostics weren't vegan for animals. The remaining folks were either religious or spiritual. Most, we had a lot of Christians, Jews, and then there's a bunch of folks who just said I'm spiritual or Buddhist or whatever. So there was a little smattering of those folks in there. But really one of the other things I was able to see is that the religious people, the religious vegans were really just about equally involved in other social justice efforts. So what the point here is that there's this kind of stereotype about vegans that they just care about the animals and they don't care about anything else. And they hate humans. Well, sometimes I hate humans. I'm not going to lie. There's times when I see stuff I wish there was a button I could push, and don't we all? But really, this is a reflection of the fact that the animal rights movement was born out of an intersectional awareness to oppression, and it continues to have that intersectional awareness. So people are involved in animal rights. They're also involved in feminism. They're also out marching for Black Lives Matter and so on and so forth. So this is why I'm very confused, because and when I did this survey, wow, most of the people who are responding are atheist or agnostic. We don't talk about that in the animal rights movement. So the atheist and humanist community has traditionally also been unwilling. So on one hand, it's the animal rights movement is not really kind of campaigning towards this demographic. And then on the other hand, I told you my own personal history is that there's a lot of kind of, there's a wall that's built there where people just don't want to engage with this argument. And so although the atheist, new atheist movement and the free thinking folks are all about applying reason thought, and all about ethics and justice, it seems that when it comes to acknowledging speciesism and expanding our moral circle of concern to other animals, it's just not happening for the most part. So what we have then, I'm going to show a few examples of some of the great leaders in the atheist movement. And we just have this, on one hand, people are talking about thinking critically, and on the other hand, just this complete invisibility of non-human animals, which I find just absolutely shocking. So for instance, Christopher Hitchens, and the article not so much as important except the title, where we're using this language where we say all the Christians or the religious people are like sheep. They don't think for themselves, which is speciesist, by the way. Sheep are intelligent animals. But we talk about humans being obedient sheep, or they're being sacrificed in the slaughter. But what about the actual sheep? So we get trapped in this kind of metaphor about humans are just going to sacrificial slaughter to religion at the altar of religion. But what about the actual sheep who are actually being slaughtered, who actually are being sacrificed? Why don't we also recognize them and the harm that the religious institutions and ideologies are doing to them? Darren Brown. I loved it when this came out. Darren Brown, in case you don't know, he is a British psychologist, but kind of a TV show psychologist. He does shows and tours and stuff. Really, really interesting guy. His earlier work is fascinating. He's just a really cool dude. But one of his things that he likes to do is he pushes back on all the charlatanism that happens in the New Agey movement, where people claim to be spiritualists and they can speak to the dead and they can read crystal balls and all this kind of stuff, and basically dupe people out of their money and take advantage of them. And I don't want to kind of write all those spiritual people off like that. Some people really truly believe that they can do that. And some people have ethics around it and, do those things for free. And it's really a service for folks and whatever. But he is definitely out for people who are trying to take advantage and exploit folks. And so one of his big things is teaching through his TV programs and through his books and all the other stuff he does, teaching people to be more critical and think a little bit more critically. And then he participates in the Got Milk ad. So if you're not an American, now I have to explain the Got Milk ad, because in the United States, the Got Milk ads have been an institution for many, many years, where the dairy industry has funded this campaign using taxpayer dollars, by the way, to kind of convince people that milk is healthy for you, that milk is so great. And it's basically just advertising. And they get celebrities and basically use the celebrity association to make people want to buy the product. So anyway, when I saw Darren Brown on there, I just couldn't believe it, because the language that's being used in these campaigns, like this one, with facts like these, do you really need anyone to persuade you that it's good for you? Where are the facts? Where are the facts? There are no facts. There's no facts. We're adult human beings who are drinking the breast milk of a bovine that's intended for a baby cow. We're the only species that hasn't been weaned, right? So another one where he's talking about powerful stuff, the white stuff. And I say the white stuff for who? Because there's an underlying racism to this, because actually the global majority cannot digest lactose. That's a white people thing. So when you're kind of saying that milk is necessary for a healthy body, then you're basically saying that the European kind of ancestry is the appeal of the kind of ideal we should all aim to achieve. So you have people who are literally getting sick, really ill, because the government and government ads are telling them you have to drink this milk. That celebrities like Darren Brown, who are based on science and fact and critical thought, are telling you this is the white stuff, the powerful stuff. And so we need to be thinking about, who actually is this audience going to be aimed towards? And actually there's implicit racism in it. We also need to be thinking about who funds this research. So like I said, the in the United States anyway, we have something called the government checkoff program. And so the government takes the Food and Drug Administration, the USDA, the United States Department of Agriculture, they take this taxpayer money and then they dole it out to the different food industries, the vast majority going to egg, milk, or egg, dairy, and meat. Very, very, the tiny fraction goes to fruit and vegetables and nuts. This is just a wild thing because there's a lot of lobbying. There's a lot of politics behind this. So they use taxpayer money and then turn it around into these big expensive campaigns. And therefore, it becomes this self-fulfilling sort of snowball effect. But we also have the dairy industry actively funding academics and scientists to create research. And so this is why, by the way, when you look at journal articles, if you look at the top or the bottom, usually it'll say this study has been sponsored by such and such grant or such and such foundation. And they have to do that because that allows the reader to think critically about, okay, if the milk industry has funded this research, could this introduce bias? The answer is yes. Yes, it will introduce bias. Because if you're a researcher, an academic, and you fight very hard to get a grant, they're extremely competitive. Not only are they competitive, but they also, your promotion rests on getting grants, right? It's very important to get grants. So there's a lot of pressure then on these academics to set up a research question that's going to appeal to that funder and have findings that will appeal to that funder. So the milk industry, and this is no secret, you can go to the dairy industry's website and they'll tell you, here's our agenda. We want to fund more research, right? So when they have these studies that come out that milk is healthy for you, whatever, you need to think that with a grain of salt because there's actually a lot of research that counters that. And at the end of the day, it's a bit of common sense, isn't it? Like I said, we're apes. Drinking the milk, the breast milk of another species, not even a closely related species. If milk is so dang healthful, why don't we drink our own milk? Why don't we drink chimpanzee milk? We're drinking cow milk. Right? So again, a little bit of common sense there. And again, it invisibilizes the cows. So in all this kind of rhetoric about food and like taxes and funding and grants and science and all that kind of stuff, where are the cows in all this? So we don't see the conditions that they're living in. We don't see the anguish that they have to go through when they're separated from their children. We don't see them heading to slaughter after 4 or 5 years when their bodies give out from all the repeated forced pregnancies and the horrific conditions that they live in. So just once again, like it's kind of talking about all this free thought, rational thought, evidence and science and all that kind of stuff, skepticism, but invisibilizing non-human animals. Sam Harris. Okay, so now we're getting towards people who are not so obscured from speciesism. So Sam Harris has spoken a little bit about this. He does acknowledge that we should extend our moral consideration to other animals. He actually was vegetarian at one point, but then in an interview he says, well, I feel like I wasn't getting enough protein, so I gave it up, which again, kind of implicitly racist because the global majority has been traditionally vegetarian or plant-based. Like the consumption of animal protein, this is a recent thing for many, many parts of the world. So when you're saying I'm not getting enough protein, you're basically saying, okay, well, what about folks in China and India and elsewhere that were traditionally vegetarian? So they're weak. So yeah, I also want to just like to always challenge when we have these stereotypes or myths about nutrition, about whose values are we basing those nutritional standards on? He also puts a lot of faith, I use that word intentionally, he also puts a lot of faith in technology to kind of get our way out of this. It's like, okay, I should be vegetarian. For whatever reason, I don't want to be vegetarian, but I'll put the faith that one day technology will save us all. And that happens not just with, Sam Harris, but we see a lot of that with people worrying about climate change. It's like, oh, science will take care of it. Technology will take care of it. Just let capitalism do its thing. That'll take care of it. But actually, I think a lot of that is kind of willful thinking and or wishful thinking. And actually, it kind of absconds us from taking actual practical action right now. Richard Dawkins, he's also kind of one that's like, And actually, like I said, I've been out of the atheist movement for a little while. And when I was getting ready for this talk, was pleasantly surprised to see Richard Dawkins come around a little bit. I'm already kind of like, because the whole elevator gate thing, but you know, Dawkins is a hero to many. So I will, I always have to say that. I'm be careful. If I say anything about Richard Dawkins, it's like swarm of trolls. If anyone's ever done that on Twitter, it's like, oh God, get ready. Here they come. Oh, please don't dox me. Anyway, so yeah, he's very influential and he's really considered a hero to the new atheist movement. So it's worth thinking about like how he's kind of transitioned his thinking on this topic. So there's a very famous interview he did for one of his documentaries, I think for the BBC many years ago. He speaks with Peter Singer, considered the father of the animal rights movement. And he says, wow, you're a really moral guy. And I wish I could do that, but I just don't think I can. But actually, as of more recently, as of 2017, he's now mostly vegetarian. So there's an article in the New York Times, I think it was. Oh, the Times. No, not the New York Times, the Times, London Times. He's like, yeah, I'm vegetarian for the most part. And he's very open about it. Just like the respondents in my study. He's vegetarian because he has empathy for other animals. He cares about what happens to other animals. And also his scientific training, he cites that as well as allowing him to recognize why other animals are important morally. But like Harris, he's also kind of, technology will save us. So very recently, a couple of years ago, he was talking about cultured meat. In the animal rights movement, the role that cultured meat could play is highly, highly debated. If you're interested in that, you can do a search on Google Scholar. And I don't have time to get into that debate. But again, the point here is that it's kind of, again, although unlike Harris, he is vegetarian, it's still putting faith in technology instead of thinking about how we can practically do steps right now that doesn't require any technology, i.e. could just go vegan and stop being awful to animals. And then I also want to think and push back on this kind of appeal to science. Although, like I said, my goal in life is to keep appealing to science in order to make the social movement seen a little bit better. But when it comes to just like people in general, the public, like how much evidence do we really need? And when it comes to the atheist movement, how much evidence do you really need? Because we got tons of it out there. We've got tons and tons of research out there that shows that non-human animals are self-aware, that they want to thrive, they don't want to experience pain. This is just common sense. If you've ever lived with a cat or a dog, you can tell when they're happy, when they're not happy, when they're scared, when they're hungry, when they're bored, when they're sick. You know, it's a basic kind of skill that human beings have, that empathetic skill, like to be able to register how others feel. It's common sense to know that non-human animals care about what happens to them. So really, how much evidence do we need before folks will be convinced that we need to take practical steps towards advancing animal rights, starting with stop eating them? So what happens then, regardless of all of this evidence, is that people will fall back on sociological or psychological kind of different techniques, whether they be conscious or not, to resist it. So one of the ones, like for instance, I saw on the Facebook page for this talk that people were making their jokes, vegans, we should eat them. Oh, really funny, like you're the first person that's ever made that joke. But using humor in that way to deflect means that people don't have to think about their morally problematic choices. You have denialism, which is also something that sociologists explore. You have cognitive dissonance, which psychologists look into. There's a whole lot of different psychological and sociological measures that people use. And if you're interested, by the way, in more of that, I can direct you to lots of different good, really good authors, including my colleague, Christoph Daunt, who works here at the University of Kent with me. He's in psychology, and he has a whole research lab just on trying to understand why people resist taking action to help other animals, or at least stop eating other animals. So really, we can have evidence all day long, but it's a matter of, do people care to look at that evidence? And that's why I think that the atheist movement is so interesting, because the atheist movement is actually defining itself by active critical thinking, active challenging to hierarchies of oppression. And yet, when it comes to veganism, there's a brick wall that appears there. And it's just very fascinating to me, because then also on the other hand, remember that most of the people in the animal rights movement are atheists. So I guess what that means to me is like, what would happen if we actively appealed to the atheist community, which is why I'm very interested. I was able to do this talk today. And then the other thing, as a feminist, I got to throw this in here, because there's like kind of fetishization of science and rational thought. But this kind of emphasis on we must be rational, we need to be very reasoned. Unfortunately, sometimes that means we shut down emotional connections. We shut down empathy as though that's something bad and not useful to us. Historically, empathy and emotions were very important for guiding our behavior, and they still are, whether you want to believe it or not. The psychological research shows that emotion steers a lot of our behavior. So the feminists would also push back on that because, of course, women have historically been stereotyped as being overly emotional in a bad way. The feminists would push back on that and say, who taught you that that was such a terrible thing? And I think there's plenty of room to acknowledge science, evidence, reason, rational thinking, and also acknowledge that we have a heart and we have capacity for compassion for other beings. And that matters. My compassion for other beings should be an important factor in why I extend my moral concern. On the other hand, I'm sure there's a lot of you who there's certain animals that you will never feel compassionate for. And so in those cases, you know, maybe we should fall back on reason and rational thought. Like, okay, they're still sentient, whether or not I like rats. And I do like rats. We should love rats. But just saying, like, so we need to be able to think of ways to balance those two and not necessarily throwing one out because, well, that's anti-feminist or because that's too emotional or whatever. So I'm wrapping up now, and I just wanted to kind of bring it back to what atheism, free thought, rational thinking, humanism, whatever you want to call it, like what it grants us. It grants us that wonderful and amazing gift of critical thinking. And we got to be honest, there's a lot of folks who have not been given that gift, right? There's a lot of people who have been excluded from education for whatever reasons, be it for colonialism, for racism, for poverty, classism, sexism. There's lots of reasons that people have not been given that gift of critical thinking or given the space. In some places of the world, critical thinking can get you killed, right? So that incredible privilege it is to have the capacity to think critically and to use it. It allows us to challenge entrenched power and to take control over the world that we live in and make a change for the better, rather than, as religion has taught us historically, than to just follow what we are told to do, right? So we've reached a point in history where we can take control over things, make the world better. We can challenge patriarchy, which we have and we are, white supremacy, capitalism and its many ills. All of these things really, really, really easily align then with the anti-speciesist project. It really helps us to challenge the hegemony of animal eating, something that we just take for granted. Many people just take for granted because it's there, it's tradition, it's kind of like a practice in the family, and it's, you have this emotional attachment to it or whatever, it just tastes good. All the different reasons that people kind of cling on to those things. Critical thinking can help us challenge that and say, you know what, actually, what does the research say on this? Well, the research says that actually eating vegan is cheaper. The research says that eating vegan is better for your health. The research says that animals have a capacity for suffering, and that's bad, right? So we want to challenge these things, then this aligns very much so with this larger humanist project, I think. So the challenge then is to, can we reject that dogma, the dogma of the evolutionary science that's very politicized, right? The dogma of human supremacy. Can we apply the art of critical thinking and the method of scientific kind of evidence gathering? Can we apply that and actually extend our compassion, right? There's also room for compassion to other animals. So if you're interested in learning more about this, I mean, there's so much to be said, and I had to cram it into a talk that's not going to put people to sleep. But if you're interested in learning more about this, my book, A Rational Approach to Animal Rights, the whole premise of that book is how can we use the scientific method to make social movements more effective? And the book is also about recognizing the power of intersectional advocacy, right? And so the very last chapter is a chapter on intersections between animal rights and atheism that I think you'll find very interesting. There's also a book by Kim Socha. Kim Socha is not a scientist, though. Kim Socha is in English studies. Nonetheless, she's an atheist. And so she's coming at it from more of a philosophical approach. And she's looking at the history of religion and why it's been very problematic for non-human animals. But then also she's looking at how atheists thought can you know, provide us a new pathway. A very, very famous book in the animal rights movement, Matthew Scully's book on Dominion. I've not personally read this because I don't want to be scarred for life, but that's a very, very, it's a big seller, and you might also find that useful. And so that's it. If you want to follow me, see what it is I get up to, you can follow me on Facebook. This is my author page, and I update it really regularly. If you want to follow me personally and see what my dog and cat, Mishka and Keely Jr. are up to, a lot of their hijinks, and whatever beer I'm drinking that day or vegan food I found, that's the place to catch my personal account. Also have an academic Twitter account, and you can go to my website. And my website has today's PDF. The slides for today's talk will be up there. I'll also have a link to the video when the video becomes available. But all of my talks, all of my publications, all of my research, everything I've ever written ever is up on my website. Because again, one of my goals is to use science to help us think about these things. And for people on the ground, social movement actors, to actually use it. So I make a big point to make sure that my research is accessible. Screw firewalls and screw big publishers that are trying to suck up all our money. So yeah, I'll stop there. I see that the chat box is popping off, and I think we're going to do some Q&A now.
Great. Thank you so much, Corey. Lots in there to think about and discuss. A reminder to folks, we are taking your questions through the Zoom Q&A feature, as well as comments on Facebook, and we'll get to as many as possible. One of the things I was thinking about when you were talking is that with our prison project, when we're trying to make sure that incarcerated people who are atheist, humanist, non-religious have the same rights, sometimes the question comes up of like, you know, we need to really explain humanism to the facility so they understand that it's not something that like the individual has made up. There is actually a movement supporting them. And it was kind of funny to me when I got the question of like, what kind of a diet does a humanist have? Because we don't have the same, you know, kosher, halal, or fish on certain days kind of rules. And I know that, you know, we, as you said, we kind of like pride ourselves in critical thinking and also, being able to think for ourselves, and make decisions for ourselves. But I do feel like we could, kind of emphasize more about the need to move towards plant-based and have kind of more intentionality in our dieting.
Yeah, absolutely. And I know I'm not as familiar with the Church of Satanism either, but I do know that they have their list of principles, and it seems a lot more animal friendly. But if folks in the chat want to add, like if they're members of the church, I started following on Facebook a couple months ago. I don't really see much vegan stuff pop up with that either, but it seems they're a little bit more explicit about being kind to animals. Is that correct? If anyone knows.
I think so. And I wonder if maybe part of that is to fight against also that assumption about sacrifices being like sort of the thing that Satan is widely connected to. We have a question here that I'm sure a lot of the arguments against moving towards veganism, you probably get it has to do with evolution and kind of, you know, we were made to eat animals. So the question kind of brings up, how do you integrate the fact that other animals eat each other into the view of the ideal world we should be working toward?
Other animals rape each other. Other animals eat each other's babies. Other animals do a lot of stuff that really doesn't relate to what we, I mean, humanism is about making choices, rational choices for ourselves and building a better future, and not just leaving it up to God and not just leaving it up to evolution, right? So I think that the atheist movement kind of prays to evolution and science in a lot of ways, just like it does with God. Well, this is how evolution has done it. So that's why I said at the end of the talk, we need to push back on some of that dogma. I think that makes people, it's a way to people easily kind of abscond themselves for having to think critically about it. A lot of animals do it, so we're animals, all right. But yeah, my dog eats chicken poop, or I'm sorry, pigeon poop. I'm not going to start eating pigeon poop because my dog does. I don't take dietary advice from other animals.
Yeah, well, and also one of the things I tend to think about is that, we have gotten to a place in society where we have a lot more alternatives. So, you know, if you really love cheese, there are various vegan cheeses that you can experiment with. And I remember that I've worked with several vegans and learned from them about pretty easy substitutions that make the switch seem just less intimidating and more possible.
Also, with the cheese thing, I think that is a valid thing people will have issues with. Like Veganuary just released its data from Veganuary 2022, and it's like the number one reason that people didn't stick with Veganuary. And Veganuary, by the way, is a 30-day vegan kind of test or whatever. And the number one was that people said I had to eat cheese. And when I went vegan 20 some years ago, we didn't have alternative cheese. You just didn't. And so I actually just kind of got used to not having it. And now there are lots of just like tons of different cheeses. Some of it, I think, I mean, it's hard to know. I don't know what real cheese tastes like anymore. But one of the things I think people should be thinking about is from the free thinking kind of perspective is why is it that we eat so much cheese? Like there's opiate type chemicals in cheese that make it so craveable. But also like cheese is widely available and it's affordable for a reason because the dairy industry is like pushing these products. It's like it's a shelf stable product and it's got this craveable kind of things in it. And it's like straight up fat. it's just not good for us anyway. So I think that for people with cheese, like maybe first off, watch some videos about what happens in non-human animals and dairy production. And if that doesn't sway you, then just look into some of the research on why is it that we eat what we eat? We don't eat what we eat just because it tastes good. We eat what we eat because of a lot of political and industry related reasons that kind of streamline and push certain foods towards us. For instance, this is the reason why we eat something like 4 times the amount of animal flesh today than we did in the 1970s, because a lot of the way the industries have kind of been subsidized to make it a lot cheaper than it actually is, but it's also kind of enforced into a lot of different shelf-stable products and a lot of processed products. So it's like almost unavoidable.
One person wrote, the simple fact is that many animals are unable to exist, quote, in the wild, and if not raised for food, would essentially go extinct. How does this factor in your thinking?
Bye-bye. See you later. I think that for a lot of vegan scholars, like the idea there is that we have an ethical obligation to take care of the animals that have been brought into existence, but we do not have any moral obligation to keep dependent domesticated animals around just for us to use. I think that's a pretty twisted kind of perspective. Like I'll just keep bringing slaves into being because otherwise they would not exist. A lot of these animals, I think the case could be made for dogs and cats that they sort of co-evolved with us, but certain animals that we use for food, like cows, look nothing like natural wild cows would look. These animals have been genetically manipulated for thousands of years to be very dependent on us. And that genetic manipulation, that ownership, that domestication, that's an act of violence. And I don't think these are not natural wild animals to begin with. These are human creations. So if cows should happen to form a herd out in the wilderness and do their own thing, so be it. But to bring them into existence and eat them and use them just so that they can say, oh, well, they exist, that's problematic.
So someone else saying, isn't cruelty towards animals one of the signs of psychopathy? Why do we atheists, humanists, and free thinkers respect animal rights and promote going vegan?
Yeah, that actually, there's a growing body of evidence to support that, not just psychopathy, but also if you are abusive to non-human animals in the home, you will probably see that person is already or will soon be abusive to children and or women. It's oftentimes men, not always. This is anecdotal to support that. Like I said, there's tons of research that's coming out. There's a new subfield in social work studies, but also in sociology. There's a lot of people doing this work. But when I was briefly a social worker, my mom is a social worker, and I had to step in one summer to take over while they were trying to hire somebody, and I just got thrown in the deep end. So I could sit down and they tell me, all right, here's the things you look for when you go on home visits. So I was in child protection. And they said, one of the things you need to do when you walk in the door is to look at the animals in the house. If those animals aren't being treated well, you can guarantee something's going on with those kids. And so indeed, there was twice that I had to make calls to animal protection because the animals weren't being treated well. And then yeah, the children as well. But we also see that in cases of domestic violence where the perpetrator will be horrible to the animal in a way to threaten like the woman or the child. So they'll be abusive to the animal to threaten them. Oftentimes women have trouble getting out because the shelters don't accept non-human animals. So it's just like a whole, it's deeply connected. Absolutely.
Someone asked, why does veganism sometimes have a reputation for conspirituality / woo / mysticism when so many vegans are in fact naturalistic, rational thinkers, as your research showed?
Yeah, I know. That's why I was embarrassed to say I used it. Like, I do identify as a witch, but I'm atheist as hell. Like, I don't believe in any, like, I just think it's kind of fun, like, as a feminist, I think it's nice to kind of embrace sort of like the natural path that, you know, has been stigmatized for so long. But there is some woo-woo. I'm not going to lie about that. In fact, I've done some research on the history of the vegan society. And I think one of the most amazing things about the founding of the vegan society is it wasn't just out of, they were like, there was like, this is so uncritical. You guys are like claiming to be against speciesism, and yet you support these horrible things that happen to animals. And some of them were like, yeah, well, you know, we don't want to alienate people too much. Da, da, da. Maybe you guys could go your own way. But also they were saying, you guys are too woo-woo. Apparently they used to have like astrology in the vegan vegetarian magazine that they came out, the journal that they came out with. So that was an explicit part of it. Veganism was founded on science, evidence, anti-woo-woo. Yeah. But then if you follow the journals, and if anyone's interested, my study on this is on my website, but also you can go to issue.com and see these journals for yourselves. And you can see this kind of arc it takes by the 1950s, really in the 1960s, it's super religious. It started off as this explicitly atheist kind of thing. And it became just soaked in kind of Christian stuff, a little bit of Judaism, a little bit of, they also collaborated a lot with folks from India. So there's a Hindu spiritualism there as well. I don't know. I don't really know like why all of a sudden it's just, maybe it was a generational thing, but then the earth movement came in the 1970s and also had a major influence on animal rights. There's a lot of intersections there, and there's a lot of spiritualism with that as well. So yeah, but that's why I was really interested when I did that study. And it's like, we have the stereotype about the hippie tree hugging woo woo kind of folks, and yet the majority of us are free thinkers.
So you touched a little bit when you're upon the connection between humanism and veganism. You're kind of going through the definitions. Someone wanted to specifically kind of explore sentientism's compatibility with the Humanist Manifesto 3, and stated the main point of ethical values are derived from human need and interest as tested by experience.
So is that what the person says, that humanism is how that's sustained? Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Sentientism, again, this is not mine. This is Jamie Woodhouse's work. And I would strongly suggest anyone interested in that, go to his website, check out his stuff, because this is his baby. I mean, I come out of just like your classic animal rights philosophy background, but a lot of that. Yeah. And the interesting thing about his project is that he brings people on the show. And it's explicitly about bridging these two things, science, atheism, and then also animal rights. And he brings people on and he asks, like, why do you think that animals matter? And inevitably people say, because they're sentient. So he's picked up on this thing where a lot of us are informed by this idea that other animals are self-aware and have interests to speak of. And so to that, that's pretty much all I can say about that. I think this is Jamie Woodhouse's kind of baby. And I know he's probably like shaking the screen right now. But if Jamie, if you're here and you want to like put in the chat, you're more than welcome to do that. But yeah, I think that the idea here is that I did notice someone in the chat here said it's not, sentientism is not just veganism. It's about challenging that whole worldview that humans are at the center and that non-human animals are not, do not matter or on the margins.
Mm-hmm. I should say that Monica Miller, our legal director, is also a lawyer for the non-human rights campaign. So she's, kind of bring us a bit more awareness about on the legal side, the work that can be done to support and protect animals. But also with when people emphasize that humanism is kind of like about and for humans, I tend to note that that humanism is really about humans recognizing and owning their accountability and responsibility for action. I mean, certainly there's a lot that we can do with animals, but you can't really organize animals in the same way that we can organize and communicate with humans. So while, of course, the term has human in it, that doesn't mean that that's all we care about. And I thought you laid out some great information about the intersectionality of these, identities that we hold or oppressive systems that society has maintained that we need to be aware of and intentionally, engage in.
Yeah. And then ultimately, speciesism is a human issue. It's human cause. So it's human responsibility to identify this problem and to deal with this problem. And yeah, not just leave it up to evolution or leave it up to God. We have to actually be actively responsible for the decisions that we are making. And it's all, yeah, intersectionality. I think that's one of the beautiful things that we have. It's even for people who are watching this and saying, bacon, if you don't care about non-human animals, like that, that has deep ramifications for other marginalized groups. And there's just, there's this huge body of work that if people are like scratching their heads trying to think of examples, go to my website, please. There's so many amazing intersections that people have identified. And there's lots of resources on my website that can take you there. But yeah, it matters for race. It matters for colonialism. It matters for class. It matters for gender. It matters for sexual orientation. I just gave a talk at the University of Cambridge last month on intersections of LGBT rights and animal rights. These things are deeply, deeply, deeply entangled. So even if you're a speciesist jerk and you don't care about animals, if you care about people, if you call yourself a humanist, you need to acknowledge non-human animals. They matter. Of course, I say they matter on their own terms, but they also matter because they matter very much so for the well-being of marginalized human groups, but for humans in general, because of the contribution that animal agriculture plays in climate change.
And also one thing that I was thinking, and I have a kind of comment question here, connect to it, is the idea of also the accessibility of the movement. When we have events, especially big conferences or even local potlucks, intentionally making sure that we have either full vegan or plenty of vegan options so that individuals don't feel left out or burdened to figure out their own food. We have someone that wrote in the Q&A that when organizing human events, they've had that problem of people pushing back against making those events vegan and claiming that that's, an imposition on the organizers and similar to forcing.
Are these organizers not leaders? They're supposed to be setting the norm. Yeah, I've seen that also, like here at the University of Kent, the anthropology department, which is our sort of sustainability kind of at the forefront, they finally agreed to make sure all conferences that they do and meetings that they do will be vegan and or vegetarian, not vegan. And then there was so much pushback from people. It's like even the people who are like doing climate change work for a living were pushing back on this. But increasingly, I see that cities, that organizations are now taking climate change seriously and actually treating it like the crisis that it is and saying, okay, we're not going to have animal products at these conferences. That's the one place people like can't go eat vegetables and fruit for 1 day or 2 days. Like that's the deeper problem. Can't eat healthy for 2 days. But this is, if we're recognizing that climate change is a crisis, which it is, we have to be able to take it seriously when fork comes to mouth. So even if people don't care about animals, if you believe in the science of climate change, quit eating meat, quit eating dairy. It's just that simple.
And needing to be, especially when we're at like a hotel or somewhere where we're working with vendors that are maybe not connected to the movement, still being strong advocates to make sure that, I've been in areas for conferences where they're like, well, we're going to give you the meat covered in cheese, classical dish of our region. And we're like, that's lovely, but we need other than that. And we need to make sure that we're not, having folks feel uncomfortable and unable to eat during our sessions, or even the typical like, oh, we've got the vegetables. Okay, but the vegetables is in a beef broth. Mm-hmm. And that just defeats the whole purpose.
Well, good for you for pushing back on that.
Someone was asking, so we're seeing a large division within the animal rights movement based about the idea of intersectionalism, and I'm seeing the person mentioned they also saw some negative comments in here as well. What do you think we as atheist vegans and animal rights activists do to heal and bring the groups together?
Well, this is the problem. There's no communication to begin with. This is one of my big things. It's like, why does the animal rights movement work so hard to appeal to Christians and Jewish folks and other religions, so much effort into campaigning, when that's not the people who are going to be easily pushed over? The people who are going to be more easily brought in are going to be the ones from the atheist community, but there's no campaigning whatsoever. And I think my suspicion there is because the stigmatization of atheists, because they're so downtrodden. It's like that if we touch that, then that's going to make us associated with it, not going to make us look good. And an animal rights movement is a business like any other. It's about that competitive grants, the grants you got to fight for. And already a lot of them won't say that we're vegan. They won't say we're for animal rights or animal liberation, because that makes it more difficult for them to get funding. Because where is this funding coming from? Major elite organizations and a lot of these places benefit from speciesism. So I think that's why the animal rights movement has probably not actively reached out to the atheist community. So unfortunately, the onus is right now on the atheist folks. If you take science seriously, I see people in the chat saying, no, humans aren't naturally herbivores. Yes, some humans can digest animal protein, but we have copious research now published in scientific journals that veganism is safe and healthier, not just healthy, but healthier. And it's better for the planet. And guess what? No animals die, or much fewer animals die. So we need to be like really challenging this notion. We take critical thinking seriously. Take it seriously, like apply it to everything. It's because people have these traditions, these ideologies, these values, and a lot of it is rooted in old religious kind of teachings that animals are subservient to us, that we are naturally supremacists, and that they are there for us to use. And sometimes that's kind of been supplanted with evolutionary talk, because that makes people feel like, okay, I can fall back on these ideologies without seeming like I'm pulling on religion. But it's the same thing. It's the same idea that regardless of what the science says, I'm going to go with my ideologies and my old fashioned traditional beliefs and say animals are still here for us to use. And like kind of just even the common sense of it, like, why are we drinking the breast milk of another species? Why are we saying we're carnivores when my fingernails, I can't ever like, they're just, what can I kill with my fingernails? What could I kill with this little tooth? Right? It's just like common sense stuff. That's like the atheist movement's like, come on, guys, come on, man. So it's, yeah, I think I'm really glad to have the opportunity to bring up this topic today, because I feel like the atheist movement really is out there. The humanist movement really out there and pushing this notion of we can actually make decisions for ourselves. We don't have to rely on these old religious problematic institutions. We can actually use the wonders of science and critical thinking. So it's really, I think it's a wonderful thing that we're starting to see those doors open up from that end, because I don't think the animal rights movement is ever going to do that as long as it's dependent on big money from big big funding sources. Unfortunately, as long as that stigma is there.
And I think that for folks that are maybe having trouble wrapping their mind around it or don't want to, I think that it's also important to think that no one's really expecting a total 180. You change your diet, you know, within like from now until you have dinner today. Like there can be steps to learning more about the options, maybe even changing so where you're looking for on a menu or how you're shopping in a grocery store. The Meatless Monday is a thing that a lot of schools have been incorporating to just, you know, kind of take that step towards being a little bit healthier. And, you know, there's a lot of research too about those kind of crash diet fads that end up causing more harm because a person just tried to do too much change too fast.
Veganism isn't a diet. It's a political position, right? So that's just like, I wouldn't advocate for no rape Tuesdays. Stop raping, right? Or don't murder Mondays. Stop murdering, right? It's an ethical position. It's not a diet. There are people who do need to transition. We do have research on that. We see that a lot of people do the transition sort of way. Then there's a lot of people like myself where I'm just like, I'm going to go vegan. This is the day I'm going to go vegan. I'm going to go vegan the day I move out of my parents' house when I have more autonomy over the food that I choose and I pay for my own food. And so I did. So, I mean, we just have different types of people. So the pressure is not, I hope no one feels like, oh, geez, there's no way I can go vegan overnight. So I'm just not going to do it, because we do know that there are different personality styles. There's different ways that people are able to do behavioral changes. The reason Veganuary is so popular, by the way, is because it's a 30-day thing. Why 30 days? Because they estimate that's about the amount of time it takes for people to change habits. And that's what eating is for a lot of us, habitual. We don't think about the things we eat. We don't think about the things we purchase. We just do it because that's what we've always done. It's one less thing to think about. Going vegan, the reason that I think a lot of people can't do it very well or don't do it is it makes you stop and think. But I'm here to promise you that the habit does change. Your taste buds also change. If you were like me when I was growing up, I hated vegetables, disgusting. And now I love them. I go nuts for vegetables. They're amazing, right? So it changes. It becomes easier. And I'm not here to lie and say that it's going to be super easy for the first few months, because you have to completely change your way, relationship with food. But it's in no way a diet. I gained a lot of weight when I went vegan because I like love food. And vegans, we have this big kind of food culture. It's not about this kind of moral, spiritual purity. It's about, oh my gosh, they have vegan mac and cheese on the menu, or the vegan cupcake shop, and you just go in there and you spend way too much money, right? It's a celebratory thing. It's not a diet of like paucity. It's a diet of celebration. And you open up to all these new foods of the world, especially for me coming from Appalachia, and like all I ate all the time was just like pasta, pizza, burgers or whatever. And then when I became vegan, it forced me, because this is 20 years ago before we had all the analogs and mock stuff, it forced me to investigate, say, Indian food, Thai food, Chinese food, Japanese food, Mexican food, foods of different places in the world, and your diet just expands so much. And I also want to address, I can't see all the comments, but I'm sure somebody's bringing this up, about what about food deserts? What about class and race barriers? That's absolutely important. Now, historically, if you ask me about this, I would say, yeah, absolutely, that class, at least, like money, that matters. But we're starting to now see research coming out that on average across the world, a vegan diet is cheaper, because a lot of the mock stuff that you guys see on the shelves, like the tofurkey or whatever, that's obviously some vegans buy that, but that big market, and it is a big market, by the way, here in the UK, one out of every four new food products that was introduced in 2019 was vegan. Well, we don't have that big of a population of vegans, right? So a lot of this stuff is actually being sold to people who call themselves flexitarian. And so those are people who are just want something that replaces the same flavor. They're not really in it for political reasons, right? So for veganism, it doesn't have to be that expensive. You replace this cheap burger with a very expensive knockoff burger. You can eat things that are much more affordable, rice, beans, pulses, a lot of vegetables that are frozen can also be more affordable. There's lots and lots. I mean, I grew up poor. I was on food stamps when I was in graduate school, and I was still easily vegan, right? So I don't really buy the kind of cost thing anymore. Now, accessibility is different. We do know that based on one's racial identity and their class background, sometimes you'll be in a place called a food desert. And what that means is that there may not be fresh food that are healthy stuff as well that's readily accessible. And that is a problem. And that actually something that I think for vegan activists, we should start paying more attention to kind of put pressure, just like putting pressure on schools to offer more vegan options. We should put more pressure on cities and governments to make sure that people in the 21st century have access to fresh, healthy foods. But like I said, it's now the time when we start pushing back on, I can't afford to be vegan because the research is not supporting that so much anymore. So if you guys are feeling like, oh, it looks too expensive, it's like, well, what are you looking at? Are you looking at the very expensive knockoff kind of fancy pizzas, or are you looking at chickpeas or frozen vegetables and like things that, you know, this is what I normally eat. Mm. That's my rant about accessibility. Sorry.
We have a question here also. Is it possible to keep an animal companion healthy that is biologically a carnivore, like a cat, on a plant-based diet?
Ah, this is a very interesting question. Dogs, 100%, because dogs like us are omnivores and dogs easily transition to a plant-based diet. Very exciting. This week, a study was just published where they found that dogs on a vegan diet were actually healthier than dogs on a conventional diet. So this is fresh off the press, like just now got published. One of the reasons they think for that is because the conventional dog food is probably higher in calories, but the dogs who are fed like conventional dog food had way more visits to the vet. They were heavier. There's all kinds of problems with them. So dogs easily can be transitioned. My dog is mostly vegan. She does get in the cat food sometimes and she does find stuff on the street. I live in city center, but for the most part, she's vegan. Whereas my cat does not eat vegan. And yeah, that's a major, major kind of ethical dilemma that vegans have to deal with. I've written a paper on that. I have a colleague who's written many papers on that. But we also now have people who do vegan veterinarian science, and they're actually doing research on how to create vegan alternatives for cats. There have been some on the market, not always palatable to cats. Some cats take to it, some cats don't. I mean, we have the nutritional science. We know how to make plant-based foods that are okay for cats, and they do the research on that. It's just a matter of, does a cat like it? So that's kind of where the new area of research is. So there's a researcher, his name is Andrew Knight. Andrew Knight is the one who just published a study on healthy dogs on vegan diets, and he's also been doing a lot of work into transitioning cats. But for most people who are vegan, who have cats, their cats eat just regular old cat food, meat-based cat food. But in an ideal world, we wouldn't have companion animals dependent on us. Like I said, I think with dogs and cats is a little bit weirder because dogs and cats have been co-developed with us. But for the most part, dogs and cats are purpose bred, or we allow them to breed and then we kind of buy them. There's a big industry about buying pets. So we kind of create this conundrum that otherwise would not be there if we lived in a vegan society. But yeah, the vegan cat food one is one of those gotcha questions that vegans kind of, there's a lot of research on that as well.
Well, and as you said, veganism is more than just a diet. It is also how we look at, all animal products being used. So there's also a lot of development in various industries about, taking out fur and leather and even sometimes it's amazing to find out what has animal products in it that you don't think about, because they're it was a shock to my system when I learned about the gummies.
so unnecessary and so nasty. Here in the UK, they have to, I love this. In the UK, it's not just called gelatin on the bag, it's called beef gelatin. And that's because it's a little bit more multicultural here in the UK. So people who, like, for religious reasons don't want to eat beef, I think that's why it's on there, not necessarily for vegans. But yeah, that's what we love to come up with, these words that kind of obscure the violence behind it, like beef, pork, gelatin, lanolin.
So thank you, everybody. I know there are a lot more comments, and I think there were some questions hidden within the comments. So we're going to make sure to give Corey the all the information, and then maybe see if there's something we want to go on from here, like another event or an article or a Q&A option. But to respect everyone's time for today, I'm going to give Corey an opportunity to give us some final thoughts and calls to action as we wrap up.
Right. So once again, thank you for having me. And thank you very much for sitting through this talk and for contributing to the chat. And my call to action is very simple. Of course, go vegan. If you're not vegan, go vegan. If you need some support on that, you need to know how to do that, you can just shoot me an email. I know Jamie and some other folks have been putting some great resources in the chat. And also, if you are already vegan, I think it's important for us to kind of continue this conversation with our fellow free thinkers, so that we can help kind of dispel a lot of those traditions and myths and ideologies that are problematic for animals and run counter to really the principles of rational thought. So it's kind of, like I said, the animal rights movement, I don't know if we can really depend on them. So it's kind of up to us to start to break that wall down. And like I said, I've got the research to show the atheists and agnostics, man, that's our people. So we'll see what we can do. So please come to my website, CoreyLeeWrenn.com. You can sign up for my newsletter there and follow me on social media. Thank you again for having me.
Thank you for joining us. Thank you to all of our audience members. We encourage you to come to our other programs. And as I mentioned, this one, as our other programs are recorded and available on the AHA YouTube channel, as well as the Center for Education website. You can go to AmericanHumanist.org/education to support and continue all of these programs, as well as you can go to become a member, find out about other events and other work that we're doing, and hope you have a great rest of your day.